Hello.
Hello, poor people. My husband and I.
Yeah. We're very happy to be here.
Can anyone do the royal wave? Hello, thanks for coming. I didn't think there'd be a turnout like this. This is more than when we did at the 100 Club as sexy piss-ups, right?
Okay, I think Mum Miranda, you know who this man is.
Say hello to Miranda. It's
hello,
good
everyone. Hiya, how are you? You're looking good, except I can't see you at the back. So I'm going to begin the interview with just a bit about John's childhood, and then we're going to go through to some of the questions that have been sent in. The initial idea was that everybody who asked a question that got read out got a signed book from John, but John has just spent quite a long time signing all the books, so everybody's going to get a signed book. Okay, so we're going to start off. We're going to start off with your childhood.
Yeah, I had one.
Yeah, you did.
Next.
Okay. Shall I go through my questions? Okay, you were clearly bright. Your mum taught you to read before you were four. How were you treated when you went to school?
Oh, like a fucking bad bastard, hateful Catholic fucking nonsense, you know? I was left-handed. See, that wouldn't have been a problem to my mum or my dad or any of us. And I thought, you know, the fact that I could read and write at five would have been, you know, helpful. No. The fucking nuns that run the school, right? Right, and in them early days, they seen left-handed as a sign of the devil. Hello. The devil has signed 350 books. Terrible, the nastiness, yeah. And the priests and all of it. But we'll go into that, you know, because I'm lucky I didn't get molested, but I know a lot did, so. Okay. Well, not willingly. It's hard to remember.
You remember quite a lot, though.
I have to, because memories are so important to me, because I had my memory taken
wiped
away from me at seven, and that absolutely destroyed me.
Should we talk a bit about that then?
Years.
So you got
we talked about my childhood, I thought.
Okay, well, before that, it was in your
childhood. Well, it was at seven.
At seven. But your very early life.
Sorry,
in the book.
Sorry, Miranda, am I being difficult?
No, you're not being difficult at all. You're being fine. Would you like to talk about meningitis now or later?
I'd like to talk about nothing at all and get drunk with a lot of you. And possibly have a round of bingo.
Do that. But a lot of the time in the book, you say that you're actually quite a kind of stickler for truth. You don't like people telling lies. Do you think that's part of that?
Goes back to meningitis. You lose your memory. You're in a coma for such a long time. You're in hospital for a year. You come out, you don't remember anybody or anything. You don't know who these strangers are that take you away. You've become for me, institutionalised. I was feeling kind of safe in a very cold, hostile environment called a hospital. That, for me, was my comfort. They pushed me and took me outside of that, so I had to fight for the right to find out who I was. So in many ways, meningitis, I've got to tell you, was God's greatest gift to me, because it made me have to find out who I really was, rather than settle for the car thief I could have grown up to being quite naturally. It's as important. I've got that gift now of being able to look at myself outside of myself. And that don't make me bipolar.
And that's because you had to learn about yourself. So you got meningitis.
You
at
find
seven.
Out who you are, and then you look back, and when the memories start flooding back, and you go, oh my God, oh, ooh, have I let myself down? Have I done anything wrong? And the guilt for not remembering your own parents and what they've done for you. Never get over that. Never, ever, ever. And I hope you hear it in the songs. That this is, you know, this is Pill Pistols. They're full and flooded with that. And that's not me being selfish, but if I've got the gift of making music, well, then it's going to have to be an accurate portrayal. I mean, I would have loved to have been a writer, and in many ways I am now, but with that added bonus of music, where I love books, they're great, I do. Listen, libraries to me, that's my church, right? You know, absolutely. And now I found this added bonus of sound that can portray the bigger picture ever so much more accurately.
When you came out of meningitis, though, there's a couple of things that happened. Obviously, you had to get your memory back.
Yeah, 4 years that took.
And also, you found that you were really sensitive to kind of certain emotional situations. You kind of seeing things.
Because of that, I clue into everything, detail. I have to rely on my memory. And I have to rely on the words of adults at that age. I had to believe what they were telling me was true. And it's a raw, spitefully painful and delicious irony to realise that really is your mum and dad, and they really do love you, and they've struggled with you and went through that. And no self-pity here from me. Everything about my life has been what those poor people had to put up with, right? With me. We're talking about the Sex Pistols now. You know what I'm saying? That's hard. So mum and dad always knew from that point on that I really relied on you telling me the truth. And we've maintained an incredible integrity, which actually unfolds at all my best mates. Look, there's Rambo, right? Mr. Rambo, do not lie. Not ever. And that's the kind of sturdiness I want to see in life, right? And that's why he's my manager. Oh, I love that fella. Please say hello to Rambo.
Oh, Rambo.
The other one, my wife, Nora, she can't be here tonight. There's a woman who won't take a fib off me. Stern Deutschland. Absolute loving character that broke like the mould as far as being German. You know the cliche of what German housewives can be? You know, Brunhilde of the SS and all this. It's true. Oh, I bought this brilliant frying pan, and she warned me, don't come home drunk unless you tell me. I fell through the front door. She found me passed out. I didn't close the door, and she woke me up and hit me with the pan.
Okay, I've got quite a lot of questions, but you know what? There's a lot of people here who've put questions in, so I think I should.
Oh, I bet. Hello.
They're all out there.
When I was really young, you know, getting over meningitis, I should tell you this, right? No one would talk to me, right? And so this is, you've got to understand, this is very impressive to me that anybody is even interested in anything I have to do or say about anything at all. It was the most loneliest, isolationist thing in my life. But it's true, you know. So being asked questions now, it's both a privilege but a terrifying situation for me. Of course, I ring like the Colgate ring of confidence up here, but I don't brush my teeth, so.
You've got lovely new teeth, though.
Yes, they're all titanium. Anyone want to punch this in the face, you're fucking going to lose your knuckles.
All right, I want to know if someone called Keith, as in K-E-E-F, is here. That doesn't sound like a Keith. You there? Well, anyway, I'm going to ask his question. Okay. His question is here. It is, what advice would you give to the teenage John Lydon? We Would you have done anything different?
Immediately what pops in my head is like the lyrics to that song, Hindsight Did Me No Good, Standing Naked in His Back of the Woods. The cassette plays. Yeah. Pop tones. That's it. You can't look back. You know, if you've made a mistake, clear it up and apologise to the people around you. Then you can step forward. But, you know, don't pretend you can fluff over hurting another human being without clearing it up.
Did you find when you were writing the book then, you must have, that must have happened quite a lot, that you realised...
I find that the young Johnny Rotten hurt me a lot, and that fucker's got to apologise to me tonight.
Would you like to ask your question about London Irish? Can you shout?
How I don't know. London Irish form your attitude, John. I'm a London Irish myself. How much did that form your attitude?
What part of Kerry does that lingo come from? You just talked in. You know what I mean? No, I'm telling you some truth here. We can all like yak on about being London Irish, but when you go back to Ireland, they don't want to fucking know about you. All right? So you're not. You're a Londoner. Yeah. Right? And look at us, we're multicultural, racial, all shapes and sizes. We are London. We are England, right? What's that new party that sounds like the dog in Star Wars?
UKIP.
What are they telling us? What are they telling us about what we are or what we're not? About what immigration is or not. They're fucking Tories in disguise, and please do not make the mistake of falling into that, all right? There's two kinds of cultures that are rubbish in this country. There's them what's got the cash and them that don't want to share it with us, right? And they love to set you up against a couple of poor sods that are starving from fucking some godforsaken country in the world. Welcome them in.
All right, look, we've got some lucky dip questions here from people. Do you want to...
You better. Listen, I'm blind as a bat, boys and girls. Really, I've been for a long time.
Come on, get them on. Don't be shy. Woohoo!
So, I've been through a lot. Social changes in this country that are really important that you understand. It was vitally, like, relevant. When I was just a tiny little kid that... Rather than listening to that endless fucking classical dreary like stuff, you know, like, oh God, dun, 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 you know, all of that, they started to play pop music, but the pop music was selected and it was a bit wank at first. So when bands like the Beatles came in, they were doing something really fucking important. And you have to understand that when I slag them off, I'm not slagging off their historical perspective to me. They were vital for my development.
But you didn't like them?
No. Yeah, okay. Oh, yeah. Willie Carroll and several other. I like the movie you did with Harvey Keitel. Yeah, you should. And, yeah.
So would you do any
doing more? That film, Will, right, was great, but at the same time, fucking horrible, right? Because Harvey Keitel's it. Like, he's a method actor, and he came on the set one night with a gun with real bullets in it, right? And one of the executive staff had told me this, and I insisted it be swapped and blanks put in, and that fucker pulled the trigger. I would love to work with Harvey again. I really liked him. I did. It took him a long time to understand me. He couldn't figure it out at all. Oh, Andy Aswell. Are there still any plans to put Jesus Christ Superstar on the road? I did the best I could there. I think I would have been the most excellent King Herod. you know? I did. I worked it. Listen, I've got to tell you, it was fucking hell, the auditions. What I'd committed myself to, that's absolutely alien to everything I know in my life, right? I had to take instructions, right? I had to be told how to dance and sing and operate. And I did all that and found there was a kind of a really interesting freedom inside of that, made extra special because I've always had a low opinion of show business people because I was stupid and ignorant. That lot love each other and look out for each other. I fucking love them forever for that. And think British Panto. I mean, they help each other. And nobody helped themselves to me wallet. And I can't be saying that about the music business, can I? They were really fucking generous. And it was a thrilling idea for a play, though. It used to, when I was very young, when we first started the Pistols, that was on down the road. And I was always intrigued by how you could get away with a play in that way without the moral religious majority wanting to, you know, basically castrate you.
I've got a question here, actually. Somebody called Claude here.
Claude?
Claude.
Oh, that's not our Claude, is that? Is that Yorkshire Claude? Yorkshire Claude comes to all the gigs. He's a proper chappy. Right?
A round of applause.
And a very important friend of ours in that, you know, that we are friends with our fans, aren't we? And vice versa, right? We know each other. I love you, Claude. You should come up here and show them the tattoo on your back, man.
And back.
Yeah.
Come on, Claude. Come on, Claude. Come on now.
Claude, 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 Claude.
What's your memories of the 100 Club, the iconic place?
Yeah, this. Not really much. They were asking me this earlier, Claude, right? Did I feel anything about the dressing room? I mean, who the fuck does? But it's once on this stage. I mean, this is really early Pistol. We only did one gig here, right? And it became legendary. And everybody in the fucking world said they were here. It was a nutty gig, right? You're the singer, you're here. And the first thing you're looking at is this pillar. And that's all you see. So, you know, oh, I really hit the big time now. And you're 3 yards from a fucking wall. You might as well fucking go back to prison, you know? Your cell would be bigger. And that's it. And that's absolutely, honestly it, that pillar. They tried to, like, I don't know, they've wrapped something around it now that kind of, like, makes it look arty. Yeah. You know, there was a time, because we had no monitors then. This is an amazing thing, too. I can actually hear what I'm saying up here, you know. In them days, nope. No chance at all. And all them early Pistol gigs, I had no idea what I actually sounded like. What I imagined was quite different. And I'll tell you, when somebody plays it back to you, it's the most fucking soul-destroying. But you know what? You pick yourself up and you start all over again. And that was a daily occurrence in the Pistols because there was no support from the band. They'd love to say, you were worse than horrible. And they were right.
Is Eamon Sylvester here? His question is, was punk just a lucky series of events?
I know what you're saying. Of course, everything in life is a series of events. But what you've got to do is you've got to have the armour or the mentality or the goods inside that you can hop on the situation really quick and be able to grab it. Now, you know, it's not ego here, but if I wasn't fully read, smart, read and write and fucking capable of like putting lyrics together, there wouldn't be a Sex Pistols. There'd be Fabian Quest and his genitals. And this is really funny because Fabian Quest was Alvin Stardust's other name. And he actually tried out for the band before me. So.
Is that true?
Yeah. So all together now, coo, coo, I want your anarchy, choo. You're so pretty vacant, there's nothing I can do. I really love your choo-ka-choo. Oh.
So look, I'm going to do, there's quite a few questions about certain people in the punk scene. A lot have come from Paul Kilby?
Yeah.
Hello. Okay, first up, Johnny Thunders. A sentence on Johnny Thunders.
Fucking junkie.
Okay.
He played the best 3-string lead guitar solo I think I've ever heard. Really, you know, he had no idea. But that was good, weren't it? But for me, the New York Dolls were already old-fashioned when they came, because we had glitter, didn't we? You know, I mean, come on. The English were far fucking further ahead playing with that transsexual fucking thing. You know, we had Sweet, Bowie, Marky Boblin, right? We had a lot going on. Even if you wanted Slade, you know? Everybody knew that was the tastiest guitarist in the world, that fuck, right? But can you explain that mullet?
I love that hair. Okay, you ready? Next one. Viv Albertine.
Oh, yes, her book.
Yeah,
oh, poor old Viv. You know this about me. I don't do gossip, right? And I never have anything bad to say about any woman ever, right? Because you should not. You should not do that to your fellow human beings, right? And so the pride and joy of her book was that she was in bed with Johnny Rotten and Sid Vicious, and we both didn't shag her.
Yeah, kind of. Well, the bit I think that she was referring to.
Now we're going to get the feminist approach.
Yeah, here you are.
Viv was a mate, a friend.
Yeah, but that's what the scene is
about.
You
know,
like.
And many things went on, but I will never tell you that because that's none of your fucking business.
Okay. Okay. Next one. Susie,
whatever we do, no, that is really important. Whatever we do in life, right? When we like, you know, punk and all that, and we're all right, but we're not out there to degenerate or grass up or be flippant and meany mouthed about anybody at all. And I love Viv; she's really great, but she was always a bit older than us and a bit posher, and couldn't quite be trusted. She could have said worse. Thank God she didn't.
Okay, Susie Sue.
Lovely girl, I suppose, but never a mate of mine, and that's all right and fine. The Banshees were like, oh, there's some great music that came out of that lot, but it really is all about Stephen King novels, and that's where my problem begins with them, right? They thrive on other people's efforts. There's not much originality. And that's a shame because I'll tell you, Severin, all of these great people, these are really, truly, truly excellent, excellent human beings. I loved her. Really tough. They came to places like Paris with us and stood up for women in that most excellent way. I like this now. It's getting to be good, isn't it? It's like we're all, you know, there's a bit of a family vibe here, isn't there? Trailer park family. Hello, Jed. Can you remember your first game at Arsenal? I never played for them. Not ever. I'm proper Arsenal, mate. I'll tell you the one thing I miss most was the standing, the swaying, the sense of loyalty, community, and that love of the game has gone. You support your local team. That's all you really have when you're really a young nipper. That's what you're aspiring to. All right? Gooner. You've got to understand what working class means. It means you're affiliated whether you like it or not. And no matter what you do, the other lot know just by the way you dress, the shape of your walk and or whatever. So no matter how much of a Brussels sprout I looked, I'll still walk like a Finsbury Park lad.
Okay, what he wants to know is, what do you think was the best lyric you ever wrote and why?
I haven't written it yet.
Okay.
If you love what you're doing, you're always striving to be that little bit better every single next time, right? I ain't what you would call your regular pop star, right? I'm not happy with anything I've done up to this point, but I'm really happy you are. There, it will always be, you know, that journey. But listen, I only got one chance in life. Now, you must bear this in mind. I won't let my mates down. I won't let my family down. I'll let the record company down.
Okay.
And that explains my career.
All right, I've got one from Magnus Carlberg. What tune could you imagine Pill making a cover version of?
Devil Woman, Cliff Richard.
Oh, yeah.
Years ago in, you know, early Pistol days in Nottingham, we got pulled up for using the word bollocks and had to go to court. And the court case was in Nottingham. And, well, of course I won. Malcolm didn't turn up, right? And that really fucking angered me, you know. This man that claims he was, like, inventing everything and was, you know, the perpetrator of it all. Right? And, you know, claiming he... Oh, the audacity of claiming he invented me. But didn't have the bollocks to turn up in court to defend bollocks. Right? And it was beautiful. And when I came out of the courtroom, it was a local Nottingham radio station, and they asked me would I go on live, and I did. And they asked me what would I like to have played. Devil Woman. I think that summed up Malcolm McLaren perfectly. He was scared shitless of a stupid court case, right? In fact, I was the only Pistol that turned up, you know. In fact, I still am the only Pistol that turned up.
Okay, I got one from Andy Haswell. It says, are you now making enough money from music, or will you do more ads? That's his question, that man there.
I will take money from anyone who gives it to me. I'm from the fucking council flats, right? You know? We ain't got rich mummy and daddy to, like, you know, give us a garage to rehearse in and masturbate, right? It's important to us to break out of the mould, right? And by doing so, give all our fellow working class lads a step up the ladder. And by doing so, teach them that you don't have to be fucking corrupt to beat the business, right? And the best thing about the business is you know, the drugs cost less because you've got good connections.
All right, shall we do some lucky dips? Do you want to do lucky dip? Yep.
Oh, God, I've got to put my glasses on again. Hang on. Listen, no, don't.
Classy bag.
I do every. I want you to understand this is a part of me. I don't like designer bags and things. When I go out with a plastic bag. There's not much in it. All right, you know? You know, your basic stuff, but. And my glasses. I like to keep it all together.
They seem to have changed.
Oh, come on, I look gorgeous and you know it. Steve Pulcheris, can you pronounce it properly for me, please? What? Pulla Harris.
If you could see Steve, he's completely bald.
Any girls here? You know what? It's odd, isn't it? Because here it goes. What are my opinions and or experiences of psychedelic drugs? Oh, I don't recommend them at all. No. No, don't do that. More for me. If I do chemicals at all, I do them recreationally, right? And that's the way I am, right? I never let it get in the way of my work. I see the two things as quite different, you know, because I'm a fucking nutter.
With a question about drugs, have you found that your taste in drugs has changed as you got older?
That's fantastic, isn't it? Yeah. What I've done is I've learned that there are combinations of things that can achieve better results. So. This is a great question. Do I consider myself a nationalist or a hoarder? Oh, minimalist. What I do is, yeah, I collect music. I love everything made by anybody. I really, really seriously love my music. And by that, I mean I've paid the money to buy the efforts of other human beings. I love what this us as a human species come up with in any shape, form, sound or concept. I love you all. Don't fucking play the flute, though.
It's a good point.
I like Jethro Tull. I did. No, you've got to get this. This is the nonsense, thinking what's punk, what's not. Fucking hell, Aqualung, that's a fucking stunning record, you know? You know, it is. And Anzi Dunbar, what a fucking brilliant guitarist. These are all the things that, you know, brought me into the world when I was a young lad, right? I had an open mind to music. And I tell you what's really funny this morning, because I've been away a bit, and I see, is it HTC, whatever that phone company thing is on, right? They're fucking sampling No Future in it, right? Yeah? No future, no future. And that's what I did with my own band, Pistols. It was off a song, Acid Drops. See, you know it, right? That's really fucking upsetting, that cheeky shit that goes on, right? They ain't got the bollocks to, like, take on our full load, but they don't mind, like, using our ideas and music to promote a crap cell phone for vacuous, mindless teenagers from Tring. That's not punk, right? I love the fucking Bee Gees and bollocks to the cunt that don't. Well, I don't like that part of them at all. I fucking hate that part. There was a brilliant period, Bee Gees. They had some great singles, like in the late 60s that are really fucking worth. All of you who don't know any better, go back and listen, and you'll get some really good, interesting insight. It wasn't just the Beatles, you know.
Okay, shall I read it out? Because this one is one word answers, please, okay? Paul Butcher. Hello. Hello. Where are you? I can't see you. Oh, hello.
Right. Oh, hello.
Okay, one word answers, please. It's quite easy. Dogs or cats?
I don't like pets. I don't, because I think it's cruel. They're not living their natural lifestyle. It's like I don't like zoos, right? Yeah. I don't. I just feel you're trapping them into your own precious little cuddle bunny world that denies them their natural instincts.
Mary Berry or Paul Hollywood?
Who are those?
Okay, they cook things. Mary Berry is an elegant older lady who knows about cakes.
Oh, I like older women.
Okay, yeah, I think you might prefer her to poor Hollywood, I have to say. Okay, open fires or log burners?
No, video projections. Jason Buck.
No.
Why did you say you wanted to kill Jimmy Savile in 1978? I said dead at the time. I was angry. He's dead. I'm not so angry. I'm glad he's dead. What can I tell you? You never speak ill of the dead. And by telling you I'm glad Jimmy Savile's dead, that's speaking well of that dead. All right? That's our kids. That's us, right? That's us, isn't it? That's, you know, hello. That explains, really, in an odd way, the punks, you know, and all of us. We knew we were being buggered by these old fucking bastards, right? You bear this in mind at the time. The Sex Pistols is being banned on grounds of bad taste. And they're buggering your fucking young sisters. Did anyone ever try to get Sid off heroin? Yeah, of course. But, you know, listen, the poor fucker was doomed. His mother was a registered heroin addict. And so where do you really go from it? I'll tell you, listen, I thought about this and I would have... You know, it drove me nuts for years. It really, really hurt when he died and all of that. Thinking about what I could have done more for him. He was fucked from the beginning. When your mother's, like, fucking fiddling with that stuff to you. And it was a really not great moment. Like, Sid was about, I don't know, maybe it was 16th or 17th birthday, right? It's hard to remember other than how ugly the situation was. It really, really hurt, right? We'd been up all night running around Acne and doing what, you know, fucking lads do in Acne. And went back to Sid's mum's house, thought we'd play some music, and, you know, and just drink some beers. And she goes, "Happy birthday, Sid." "Oh, thank you, Mum. What is it?" And it was a little bag of fucking heroin with a couple of needles, right? And this is a long time before the pistols now, right? And he goes, "Oh, don't worry, John. You know, she means well. It's just going to help me relax later." And, you know, and I let that one go, and I should have fucking exploded at the time because I know better. But Sid's mum was very ungenerous anyway. You'd be out all night and she'd be there. She's very, very toffee-nosed about herself. And she'd have one particular instance, I remember this, it was she'd cooked deviled kidneys for Sidney Vicious. And I had no concept of, like, what that was, you know. I mean, like, I love offal. It's awful, I hate it. Right, and but this Mediterranean dish thing, and she goes, "Oh yes, it's a recipe I learnt in Ibiza, but there was none for me." you know. And for instance, with Sid come to my parents' house, there'd always be something for everyone. Right? And that's the environment he was brought up in, that unsharing, just for him, but cold and unemotional and detached, and making him feel terrible, like his mates were embarrassed. And she never, ever, ever did anything to try and correct making him feel not special, but unspecial because of that. So poor Sid really, really went through it, right? He's my mate, and he'll always be my mate forever and a day. But when parents do that to you, it sets you off on such a fucking, like, bad trip, right? And I got to tell you, there was nothing ungenerous about Sid, but his mother was, right? And she fucking gave him smack, you know? That fucking bitch needed to be smacked senseless.
Hey, Garrett.
Alan McCubbing, I'm 52 days time and still feel as excited as I did when hearing Anarchy in Public Image for the very first time. So am I, in odd ways, you know. Every now and again, I put the record on and I go, oh, fucking hell, that was me. Oh, I'd like to be him. And then I find out I am. My wife has slowly but surely accepted you're not a total wanker. Shh, you fucking ruined the punchline. She quite likes me these days. Is this a midlife crisis? It's a mild life crisis. You really don't want your missus to like me that much, mate. Because as I've found out over the years, housewives really do like me. And I'm sorry, hubbies, you know. You've all got to have a job and thing, but... didn't I do wonders and I'm a celebrity? Oh, I mean, fucking hell, we're going to have a crisis. We might as well have a mid one. Everything in life is a crisis. Everything, right? We're all so fucking precious about ourselves. We assume roles, don't we? We assume, like, oh, you know, I shouldn't be doing that at my age. One of the most poisonous things I think I've ever heard when I was young was, act your age. I can't fucking act. You've seen me in a film. You know, be what you are, right? And bugger the fucking rest of them. Good on you, mate.
I think that is pretty much it. What's happening with the book?
I'd like you all to know, like, you know, the girl's putting up with a lot with me. You know this?
It's fun. I like it.
Because I'm a bit of an uncontrollable monster. But you're lovely.
Oh, thank you very much, John. So are you. You're the man.
I don't normally do that, but she's really fucking decent, and I like you to understand it. It's really important. It really is.
I'd just like to say that this place is completely packed, and you are a really brilliant audience. You've been really concentrating. It's really hot. The questions are brilliant, and I just wanted to say thank you for that.
Your respect is so understood.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to say thank you to the one, the only, John Lydon.
Thank you.